The Hudson Library and Historical Society's 2017 Author Series presents local author Brad Ricca speaking about his new book, Mrs. Sherlock Holmes, the true story of New York City's greatest female detective and the 1917 missing girl case that captivated a nation. Recorded at the Hudson Library's Flood Meeting Room on January 18, 2017.
Good evening. Good evening and welcome to the Hudson Library and Historical Society. Thank you for coming out tonight. My name is Polly Reynolds and I am the Head of Adult Services and Archives here at the Library. Just a few quick announcements before we get started. I just want to let you know that C-SPAN is filming tonight for Book TV. Just a reminder, so please silence your cell phones. And during the question and answer, we will be passing a microphone, so if you could wait for the microphone before asking your question, that would be very helpful. Following the program, there'll be a reception and book signing in the library rotunda. Just head back out these doors and head back into the library, and there'll be refreshments, and you can get your book signed, meet the author. So I hope you'll join us. I'm very honored to introduce tonight's guest, author Brad Ricca, who will discuss his latest book, Mrs. Sherlock Holmes, the true story of New York City's greatest female detective and the 1917 missing girl case that captivated a nation. Ricca is also the author of Superboys, The Amazing Adventures of Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster, the creators of Superman, named a top 10 book on the arts by Booklist, and won the 2014 Ohio Anna Book Award for nonfiction. His poetry collection, American Mastodon, was the winner of the 2009 St. Lawrence Book Award. In 2014, he was awarded a Cleveland Arts Prize for Emerging Artist in Literature. Ricca teaches at Case Western Reserve University as a Sages Fellow. Please join me in welcoming Brad Ricca.
Thanks, Polly, and thanks Hudson Library for inviting me out, and to C-SPAN for coming out too, and most importantly to all of you for coming out on this gray and misty evening, which is really perfect for the things we're going to talk about, for gloom and doom and murder and despair. We're going to talk true crime today, and I have a confession to make. This is a detective book in so many ways, a mystery book, is that I really hate true crime. And I know hate is one of those words, you know, I know my mom told me never, we don't hate anything, but I really hate true crime. And it goes back to, I think, a lot of different places, but I know I worked at a bookstore after college, and you go by the true crime section, which I avoided at all costs, and there's those little mass market paperbacks with those men staring out at you, and they're always black and red like Soviet propaganda posters, and they're awful. And if you happen to just open one up, you see the pictures, the photos, and they're even worse. And I always thought, how unfair to have a book that you open up and see things like this. And I'm not judging you if you like true crime. I think that's great. I will never judge someone on the kind of books they like. I like comic books. But I hate true crime. At the same time, there's something about it. You grow older that doesn't go away. So even though we put it in the back corner of every bookstore, you know, it's always this really short shelf and it's always hard to find, we don't want to acknowledge it, but it's still there. True crime is real. You have genres like fiction, like poetry, like nonfiction, which I'm not sure what that word even means anymore either, but true crime is what it is. When you read a true crime book, and it says the word death, it says the word murder, that word is real. It's not an imagined character. So it has an extra weight to it. True crime is always at the door. where I live in Cleveland, every Wednesday we get a coupon circular in the mail. I'm sure some of you get this too. And you open it up and it's on newsprint, and there's all these coupons for things like frozen peas or a magical hose that somehow, you know, zips up and is flexible. But on the last page of the circular, there's always this little picture. Does anyone else get this? A little photo of someone who has disappeared. And it's not always a woman or a girl, but 9 times out of 10, it is. And it will give the person's name, the date they disappeared, and sometimes it was a month ago, sometimes it was 20 years ago. And sometimes it has that awful photo next to it, the computer-aged version that looks like it was some bizarre watercolor where they're smiling somehow. And we know they're not smiling. So even though I hate true crime, I respect it. And as I grew older, and I'm just kind of telling you where the book came from, I would get those things in the mail and wonder, you know, how has it come to this? That when someone disappears, we get information about it through the mail with coupons for spinach, peas, and hoses. And then we look at the picture, we decide we don't know the person, and then just put it away or throw it away or use one of the coupons for 15 cents off the frozen peas. I don't like frozen peas either, so I'm not sure why I'm using that as an example. But how do missing people, missing girls, missing women, how have they become something that is so digestible to us? And that's one thing I was really interested in, kind of as a person, as a writer, and you know, writers often feel kind of powerless about things. You know, we're not in law enforcement or in positions of power all the time, but there's ways to work out these ideas in the writing. So that's what I really wanted to write about, this idea of how has it come to this with missing girls in 21st century America. So I went looking for a story, because I didn't really have a story to tell about this, but I knew there had to be a story out there that could get at these issues for me. So even though I hated true crime, there had to be a story out there that would do it. That's when I met Grace Humiston. I didn't actually meet her because she lived 100 years ago, but I was doing research on an Italian crime organization, which is, you know, that's something a writer would say. Well, it was Saturday and I was doing research on an Italian crime organization. And I was going through an old copy of the New York World, which is an old newspaper, and looking for information on this organization called the Black Hand. And I read some article and it sounded, you know, pretty much all made up. So I was just clicking through the pages and all of a sudden I saw this picture, and it was a woman, a middle-aged woman, and she was like this. So she was in the detective pose, and the headline read, "Mrs. Sherlock Holmes has done it again." I said, "Mrs. Sherlock Holmes? I don't know Mrs. Sherlock Holmes. I love Sherlock Holmes." So I read the article and I couldn't believe what I was seeing. That there was a woman in New York City who was, as I found out in subsequent research, extremely famous. In fact, for a time, she was the most famous detective in New York City, arguably the most famous detective in America. And she was called Mrs. Sherlock Holmes. And her main mission in life was to find missing girls. So I knew there was my story. When I knew there was true crime, ominous and scary and real, but that's why we should write about it, because it is ominous and scary and real, because it is just outside the door. So I'm going to read a little from the book. And it's mostly one chapter I'm going to read, and there'll be no spoilers. And I say there's no spoilers because I don't think of this book as a biography. And a biography, you can't really have spoilers for a biography. A biography is kind of like the Titanic. You know someone's born, they kind of do stuff, and then they, you know, die. Everyone knows the ending to a biography. But this I don't think of as a biography. I mean, I never wrote it as a biography. Her name isn't even in the title, and that's by design. And it's not really a true crime book, because like I said, I'm not a huge fan of true crime. It's a mystery. I wrote it as a mystery, and I wrote it as a mystery because it is a mystery. This woman, Grace Humiston, who you're going to hear about, we don't know that much about her. So once I realized that we couldn't find all the details of her life, she became like the missing persons she looked so hard for. So I'm going to read a little bit of this. I'm going to give you some context on her, but I am not going to give you any spoilers. And you'll find out why, because there's one, the book itself is, I wrote it also like a case book. So I loved Sherlock Holmes, you know, growing up. You know, you read that first story and then someone tells you there's more and you say, how many? You know, and how soon can I read them? And then when you finally read them all, you're devastated. But the thing I love about the Holmes stories is they're all cases and the cases come first. And we really don't even know that much about Sherlock. He just kind of, you know, does his thing, but his personal life is very much in the background. And you only get these little tantalizing clues like, wait, Sherlock's, you know, doing drugs? What's happening? So I kind of wrote the book like that, as a case book of her most interesting cases. And there are many I left out, but these were the big ones. So that's my introduction. I'm going to read you part of the mystery that is Mrs. Sherlock Holmes. There was important news on the front page that day, but it was the photograph of a girl in a white dress that made people stop and stare. Appearing just below the headline, the young woman was not famous, but she certainly looked familiar. She was seated with her hands at her side, her dark hair pulled up and back, topped off by a great white bow. She was seated with her hands on her side. She smiled out past the stories of U-boat attacks and President Woodrow Wilson, her face blurred by gray half-tone dots. Ruth Krueger was 18 years old when she appeared on the front page of the New York Evening World on the day after Valentine's Day, 1917. She had been missing for 2 days. Ruth had left her family's apartment on the previous Tuesday to have her ice skates sharpened. When she didn't come home, her family called the police. Detectives tramped through the snow and rapped on doors. They tracked down rumors of a secret boyfriend and talked to witnesses who said they saw her stagger into a mysterious taxi cab. But these clues led nowhere. The owner of the motorcycle shop where Ruth had picked up her skates, an Italian named Alfredo Cocci, let detectives search his store until they were satisfied. As the snow melted and weeks turned into months, the police concluded that Ruth had probably just eloped with an unknown suitor. Ruth's father, Henry, didn't like that. He wrote a pointed letter to the mayor. Then he held a press conference. In front of reporters representing many of Gotham's nearly 20 daily newspapers, Henry Krueger, a short, bald accountant, told all of New York City that his daughter was a good girl and had unquestionably been kidnapped. Henry's wife and two other daughters stood beside him, their eyes red and wet. Perched behind them all was an older woman wearing a black dress with a matching hat that swept down her neck like a sick old bird. She looked to be in her 50s and was presumed to be the missing girl's grandmother, apparently already grieving. So when Henry Krueger introduced this woman in black, as the family's new lawyer and primary investigator, the reporters were surprised when she snapped forward and demanded that from now on, all clues be given directly to her. Her name was Mrs. Grace Humiston, and for the work she was about to do on the sensational Krueger case, facing off against corrupt police, an unseen criminal society, the insatiable New York media, and a mysterious pale man, reporters would give her the singular moniker of Mrs. Sherlock Holmes. In 2 short months, Grace Humiston would become the most famous female detective in America. In less than a year, she would disappear. Born in 1869 with a claim to old New York money, Grace, her name then Winterton, went to Hunter College before embarking on what she thought would be a long teaching career at the all-boys collegiate school on the Upper West Side. After she was married, her husband, Dr. Henry Quackenbush, was accused of peephole practices at his office. Grace divorced him, quit her job, and enrolled in an evening class at the NYU School of Law, the only school in the city that admitted women. Seated in the front row, she graduated in 2 short years, ranked 7th in her class. Around this time, she also began to wear black. After a short stint at the Legal Aid Society, she passed the bar and opened the People's Law Firm. The woman in black began to get an almost legendary reputation among the New York immigrant poor. She challenged government deportations, helped underage child workers who weren't being paid at their jobs, and even recovered lost jewels for a grateful foreign ambassador. After winning a highly publicized appeal that saved the life of a young Italian mother who killed a man who was trying to rape her, Grace became known as the people's friend and was soon one of the busiest lawyers in the city. She then noticed a disturbing pattern of young men going missing and followed the clues all the way to Florida, where she uncovered a system of forced slavery through debt 40 years after the close of the Civil War. She reported, and this was a plantation she found in Arkansas. It was an island, and it was called Sunnyside. And it was effectively a slave plantation 40 years after the Civil War had ended, using Italian immigrants. And the cotton company would lure these people from Italy, saying, come to America, we'll give you a job. And they had them sign all the paperwork, and they, of course, couldn't speak English. And they were really signing their lives away because it was a system of debt that they could not get out of, that they literally had to work until they died and were buried on the plantation. So it was a loophole for these very unscrupulous and evil cotton plantation owners to get cheap labor after the Civil War. And she uncovered this. She infiltrated the camp in disguise, selling scissors, and it was a big case for her. After testifying before Congress and making front page news with the Sunnyside case, Grace returned to New York and once again threw herself into the strange and unusual cases that somehow always found their way to her desk. She fought against the same doctor who tormented the famous reporter Nellie Bly when she went undercover at an insane asylum and was marked for death by the sinister Black Hand, the Italian crime organization that used secret codes and mystical rituals. Eventually, one of Grace's rich society friends, Mrs. Felix Adler, called to tell her that a girl had gone missing in New York and begged her to meet with the father of the girl, one Mr. Henry Krueger. By the time Grace agreed to take the case, Ruth Krueger's photo had appeared in newspapers all over the country. Her image even flickered in front of movie theater audiences. The press, drawn to the story of a pretty Sunday school teacher who had vanished, openly suspected white slavery, foul play, and romantic entanglement, sometimes all in the same story. Juicy clues were flooding the detective precincts, but none of them panned out. But Grace took a different approach to the case. She locked herself in her office for a week to study every scrap of paper related to it. Grace had been trained as a lawyer, but her inability to trust the police, or even the law itself, had, over the last few years, turned her into more of a detective. Now, at age 48, her formula was to search for clues herself, verify them, and use them in the courtroom to make her arguments. She didn't trust the police, so she effectively just found her own evidence. In this case, Grace kept coming back to Alfredo Cocci, the man who had sharpened Ruth's skates, Since being questioned by detectives, Cochi had also disappeared. Though most of his neighbors speculated, he simply feared being made a scapegoat for the crime, especially because he was Italian. The police, it seemed, could blame his people for anything in those days. And it's true at this time, everyone blamed the Italians. If anything was criminally related, they would just blame the Italians. But though Cochi's place had already been searched, his motorcycle shop was the last place Ruth had been seen. Grace wanted to see it herself. This is how Grace ended up standing in the middle of Manhattan Avenue in Harlem and staring up at the Metropolitan Motorcycle Shop in June of 1917. Grace craned her neck and took in the tall glass windows that ran almost 10 feet high across the front of the store. The white lettering across the glass read, "Motorcycles Storing" on the left and "Auto Supplies" on the right. She saw tin signs for Mobil Oil that hung still in the air. A single globe lamp hung off a pole in front of the entrance, and a huge billboard for graham crackers, as big as long as the shop itself, rose off the roof and into the blue sky. The inside of Cochi's shop was dim behind the smoked glass. Maria Cochi, Alfredo's wife, had been left behind and was now, when her husband disappeared, and was now desperately trying to keep the store afloat. She had two small children. Maria, who claimed to have no knowledge of where her husband was, had refused any further searching of the premises. The police were no help either. As Grace moved from desk to desk in city buildings, trying to gain entrance to the store, police officials smiled and said their hands were tied. Grace was limited to what she could see from the outside. There were two signs in the window that read "Mechanics Help Wanted" and "Selling Out." On the outside, to the left of the front door, was a narrow stairwell that sank into the ground and served as a separate entrance to the basement. Grace walked near these stairs as unobtrusively as possible. Grace knew, like it or not, that all of her misgivings about Cochi and his store were all circumstantial. The police had searched the cellar twice and found nothing but absence. The rest was gossip and headlines. Why was Cochi missing? Because he had taken the girl? Because he had been spirited away by the same fiends who had taken poor Ruth? Or was he just terrified of being blamed by proximity? Perhaps there were more sinister forces at work, such as the rumored white slavery ring that stretched all the way down to Brazil. Or was this the work of the Black Hand? There were even rumors that Cochi had been very friendly with the motorcycle cops in his neighborhood. Grace knew that those questions might be the most dangerous ones, but they still had to be asked. Grace paused, considering the options at play in her mind, intersecting like the city itself, still struggling to connect its new boroughs into one unified whole. Perhaps Ruth and Cochi were the happy couple in this after all. That version of the truth seemed remote. But still, Grace went back to her office, thinking through the heat, trying to come up with a plan. When she got to her office, she called her good friend, the private detective named Julius J. Crone. Crone was a federal agent when he was first assigned to Grace during her U.S. District Attorney days. And Grace, one of the things I found out, she was the first female U.S. District Attorney. This is, I think, a major historical point. And you have to look really, 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 really hard to find it anywhere. It's a major accomplishment. A proud son of Hungary, with dark features and a scar under his left eye, Crone had a keen mind and chomped on cigars. When he was first hired, representatives of a southern plantation offered him a substantial amount of money for a jury list on a peonage case. Crone smiled and agreed, but not before setting up a sting in an Italian restaurant with the help of the Secret Service. After that, he was known as the man who could not be bribed. He and Grace had been partners when needed ever since. he's kind of like her Watson, except he's really prone to punching people in the face. You really, these characters are not, and you know, again, I hate true crime, but you can't make this up. And that's what makes it so good. He has a scar and an accent, and he punches people in the face. At the Hotel Manhattan on Madison and 42nd, Grace filled Crone in on the particulars of Ruth Krueger's disappearance over oysters. Crone knew about the case from the newspapers. "I want you to meet Mr. Krueger, the girl's father," Grace told her grim friend between sips of tea. "He is a mental and physical wreck. If this isn't solved soon, he'll be in a sanitarium." When they left the hotel at 8, Grace gave Crone the bulk of the files she had on the case, hundreds of typewritten pages. Crone took the pages home and studied them all night long, making big blue pencil marks over the most promising leads. In the morning, he blinked his eyes, took an icy shower, and ate breakfast. Before leaving, Crone kissed his wife, Estelle, and his three young daughters goodbye. After what he had just read, he tarried over them a moment more. When Crone arrived at Grace's office, he found her already talking to Henry Krueger, who looked completely washed of color and form. When Grace introduced Crone, Krueger's eyes pleaded at him from under his bushy eyebrows and bald head. "Mr. Crone," he said, "won't you find my little daughter? Someone is keeping her. She would never stay away. She would never have gone away." "We hope to, Mr. Krueger," Crone replied with his sliding accent. He added, "Just remember that all of the thousands of girls who disappear every year, over 98% are located." Crone managed a persuasive smile through the lie. "Yes," Henry cried, "but where?" Crone had no immediate answer. Both Grace and Crone knew that in the past year, 828 people had gone missing from the city of New York. 244 people had been murdered. "Either New York is the most criminal city in the world," Grace would say, "or the police force is inefficient." After Krueger left, Grace looked at her right-hand man. "Crony," she said, "you are the only man I can trust to dig up the real facts. There is something crooked behind this whole thing." For the next week, Grace split her time between the office and searching cellars, vacant lots, and asking questions around the tenements. The police made fun of her. But Grace was adamant that Ruth was not a wayward girl who had eloped as a result of a senseless head. Every interview she had with Ruth's friends and acquaintances had suggested otherwise. And this is, I think, one of her great legacies, that in the past, when a girl would go missing, it was always her fault. And, you know, to some extent, this still happens. But Grace was adamant that it wasn't her fault, that she knew that someone had done this to her. And it changed the whole investigation. Crone had disappeared as well, as Grace knew he would, going deep into the case. When he finally called, Grace had started to set her own larger plan into motion. "Mrs. Humiston," Crone said, "I've got something on Cochi." An hour later, Crone sat across from Grace at the hotel again. He looked over his shoulder and dropped his voice. Crone told Grace about someone he had talked to who used to live on Cochi Street. Her name was Madame Muriel, and she was a French actress who lived with her 16-year-old daughter, Philippa. Their house was across the street from the motorcycle shop. When Philippa's bicycle broke one summer, her mother sent her to get it fixed by Cochi. When Philippa came back, her bike was not only fixed, but it was wiped clean. The girl opened her hand and showed her mother a rose that Cochi had given her. Another day, Philippa went over to the motorcycle store to see if Cochi could attach a small motor to her bicycle. Cochi wiped his hands on his rag, looked at her bike, and said he'd do it for her cheap, just for her. "Oh, really?" said her mother when her daughter told her. "Yes," said Philippa, "because he told me he likes me." As her mother watched from the window, she saw Cochi and her daughter Philippa going to the store. Suddenly, she had a sense of unease and ran down to the street. When she reached the head of the basement steps, she heard her daughter screaming, "Mother, mother!" Her mother screamed her daughter's name, and she came flying out, sobbing and shaking with terror. The sleeve of her dress had been ripped loose. "I could see the spots already turning blue," her mother said, "from the grip of the man's fingers." "I want all mothers to know," she said, "how easily these things can happen. There was that man right across the street from us, and yet he dared to commit this deed in broad daylight within a few yards of our home. I wanted to go at once to the police, and I'm sorry now that I didn't. I had forgotten the name of the motorcycle man on Manhattan Street until his face stared at me from the paper." Finishing her tea, Grace was seeing someone new appear in her mind. Something worse, and he had been under their faces the whole time. She had a new fact she was now absolutely sure of. "This man," Grace said, "should have been behind bars years ago." "We'll make up for that," said Crone. But they needed evidence to catch the monster and to hopefully find Ruth alive. They needed to get into that store and the mysterious cellar beneath it. Grace had been thinking about this problem almost constantly. She saw an opening that wouldn't make them reliant on the unhelpful police. In fact, it would probably be best if they didn't even know about it. She then asked Crone a very strange, pointed question. She asked him if he knew how to fix a motorcycle. That night, Crone took out some ragged clothes and puzzled over a borrowed motorcycle repair manual. He stayed up late with the aid of coffee and light, trying to figure out how to fix an all-chain drive. The next morning, Crone knocked on the door at Cochi's store. When Maria Cochi answered, Crone told her he was here for the job. She looked him over, then asked what experience he had. "Several years," replied Crone quickly, looking her directly in the eyes. "Then get to work," Mrs. Cochi said. "Clean out that clogged gasoline on the red one first." Crone paused. He had never monkeyed with a motorcycle before. He had a car of his own and could tinker it up all right, but he'd have to experiment with the cycle. And he hated these clothes. He was a notorious dresser. He always would always wear these tweed jackets, even in the summer. So in having to dress down for this job, he didn't like it. But she was standing right there, watching him. "What are you standing there?" she said. Crone heard her emphasis on there and looked down at his feet. He was standing on an iron grating that had hot air blowing up from the basement. It was late spring, so there should be no need for heat, Crone thought. He wondered if there was equipment down there. "Why, I'm looking for a place to hitch my coat," said Crone, stalling. Mrs. Cochi pointed with her thumb to a nail on the wall. As he hung up his coat, Crone asked, "Is there any other helper here, ma'am? If you don't mind my asking?" "I do mind you asking," Maria answered, mimicking him. "Don't ask so many damn questions." And this is actual, I'm not making all the dialogue in here, none of it's made up. It's either from court documents or there's some other stories on it. For a week, Julius J. Crone, the Hungarian detective who could not be bribed, fumbled and bluffed his way through motorcycle repairs as Maria Cochi watched over him like a hawk. Crone would commit the bike's maladies to heart, learn how to fix them at night by reading the manuals, and try to put this knowledge into effect the next day. He had more than surprising success. The more daunting exercise was dealing with Mrs. Cochi. All the while, Crone reported back to Grace everything he was learning about the shop. They would meet at her office or in hotels and would pass on the information. The one-story building was largely taken over by motorcycles, most of their repairs long overdue. There was a workshop in the cellar, but it was only accessible through the outside stairs in the front. Mrs. Cochi never let him go down there. Whenever he needed tools, she would go down and bring them up herself. Crone didn't think she trusted him, or anyone for that matter. On the fifth day of Crone's new job as a mechanic, a customer brought in a motorcycle that needed three of the front wheel spokes replaced. All Crone needed to do was solder it, but the equipment was in the basement. Without pause, Crone began to put on his hat and coat. Mrs. Cochi stopped him. "Where are you going now?" she asked. "The smithy, to get these spokes soldered." "You don't need to go to no smithy," Mrs. Cochi said. "I'll take you downstairs and you can use the heater there." Crone put his hat and coat back on the tack. He made sure to control his breathing and to conceal his eyes. Mrs. Cochi wiped her hands and he followed her outside the shop. At the front sidewalk, there were four steps that led down to the cellar. As Mrs. Cochi remained standing on top to watch the store, Crone jumped down. Mrs. Cochi kept an eye on him as he went inside. When Crone entered the basement, he tried to take it all in as quickly as possible. There was no lavish furnished space or medieval dungeon. There was only a workbench, a massive tool chest, some rags in a corner, and the slick smell of motor oil. There were two windows facing the front small alley. Crone scanned the wooden boards on the floor for new damage or shiny bright nails, but even the dust was uniform. Crone knew that the police had already searched this room twice. "Don't you see the heater there in front of you?" Mrs. Cochi shouted from the stairs. There was a pause. Crone looked around again for a footprint or a scuff. Anything out of the ordinary. He started searching the back wall when he suddenly realized he had taken too long. "Never mind, come on up," Mrs. Cochi said quickly. "Take the spokes to the smithy." At that moment, Crone was convinced of two things by Mrs. Cochi's high-pitched voice. One, that there must be some kind of tiny clue in that basement. And two, that the jig was up. Crone grabbed the spokes and scrambled up the stairs. He could hear a customer in the shop. Maybe Mrs. Cochi just wanted him out of the cellar rather than leave him unattended. Maybe there was nothing down there after all. The tools were valuable, but not as valuable as what he was looking for. There was no secret cell or hidden door, or at least he had not seen one. It was just an ordinary New York cellar. Maybe Mrs. Cochi hadn't noticed his absence at all, but when he came up the stairs, her eyes were locked on him. "I know you now," she said. "You're another of those detectives that chased poor Al away. You're no mechanic, you're a hound." She broke down crying, "Get out, get out, get out." As Crone was pushed out into the street, he knew he had failed Grace. Her plan had worked beautifully until he got in that basement and had blown his cover. Crone slouched inside and walked away from the store alongside the black cars. He was convinced completely that he had missed something in that underground room. He understood now. He would stop at nothing, to get back to that still space to find out what really happened to Ruth Krueger. Thank you. So I think we're going to do some questions, if anyone has any. Anyone has any questions or comments? Or
hi there. You mentioned that she disappeared, and any information at all about where she ended up and what happened?
So this is a new book for me. I mean, it just came out 2 weeks ago. And I'm kind of, in starting to do these readings and such, I'm trying to answer questions, but at the same time, not giving out spoilers. Because I know I don't like it, you know, and it's so hard nowadays, you know, because everybody, you know, but I can't answer your question. There's very little information we have about why she disappears. And I have a theory in the book as to why she disappears. But I can, you know, say a few things. So she takes on her final case. You know, Sherlock Holmes has his great final case. Her final case involves, she takes on the U.S. Army, which is not a small enemy. And what happens is people involved in this case stretch back to her earliest, some of her earliest cases. I think the short way of saying it is, when you're someone like her, who gets a lot done, and who is a woman, she made many enemies. And I think at the end of her career, the enemies finally come out. And they make decisions that get rid of her. And I don't mean to say get rid of her like, you know, mafioso get rid of her, but there's an assassination attempt on her. Maybe two. I think it's two. But I think her end is, in some ways, it doesn't matter, you know, because she would say it was the fight that mattered. But the end of her life is, I think, fascinating. And I think there's a couple cases she does at the end that, you know, again, you can't make this stuff up. But it's not a fictional character. And, you know, I joke around that I hate true crime. But it's, I really don't, because it's real. You know, I mean, I wish it wasn't real, but it is real. So she's not like Sherlock Holmes, who kind of gets through everything and everything's happy, you know, except for the morphine use. But she's a human being, and she has a pretty dramatic fall at the end of this book. Very dramatic.
Hey, I have a question about the tone and the language that you chose to use for this piece, for this book. Because you say it is a mystery in many ways, but you also did so much research from the papers and all. How did you set about the voice, or did it find you?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think it's I like putting the reader there, because I know I like that as a reader. So. I try to, when I do description, I look at a lot of old photographs. So I was lucky I got two photographs of the store. And I promise you every detail in those photographs found its way into this book. But, you know, the graham cracker sign. And so I don't make stuff up. It's all there. But I think that it rings true. And as far as the language, I really wanted it to have some of that, you know, early... you read these papers long enough and it just starts to leave its mark. You know, the language back then is very fast. And there's all these great slang words. So I just kind of used them as is. And I think, you know, there's nothing you have to like look up, you know, it's all, but they have a lot of different terms and strange terms. But I wanted it to have, because part of what I want to investigate is the role of mass media in this. And, you know, mass media just takes this story and explodes it. And so I'm interested in, does that help Ruth Krueger or does that hurt Ruth Krueger? And the mass media, the newspapers at this time, everything's just this huge, big thing. So there's a lot of hyperbole. There's a lot of big talk. But so that's part of it too. And I wanted it to have that kind of noir feeling to it too, because it's a mystery, you know?
Did this because I knew your role, were you? What were some of the sources for your research on this book? How deep were you able to go? What avenues did you take?
Yeah, that's a great question too. So those of you that do research, you know, there's two levels. So once I heard about her, you know, the first kind of alarm that goes off is, well, somebody else must have written a book on her. So there's that first, you know, really fateful Google search. And I was astounded that there were only like a couple online articles and, you know, nothing big. But then I was sure. I was so sure that somewhere there was an archive of her papers. You know, she was this big lawyer. Her letters, her correspondence, or nothing. I looked for a year. Nothing. Nowhere. The only thing I found was a letter she wrote to Amelia Earhart. And it's like six words. It's like, good luck. and that's it. So at that point, I considered dropping the project because I had nothing to work from. But in many ways, that kind of resulted in a better product, because what it made me do was think, well, if I have no primary sources or very few, why not tell the story like it was told to a readership, like it was told to people reading the newspapers? So once I that kind of clicked in my head, I just read all the newspapers. And I was astounded at the good stuff they had. And people were telling me, well, you know, it's always all yellow journalism back then, and you couldn't believe any of it. But I found great stuff, and I found newspapers that agreed with each other. But I also found, like, I tried to find a grand jury. I wrote, you know, a judge in New Jersey saying, you know, hey, can you release this grand jury file? You know, it was 100 years ago. And he said, no, of course I can't. Which, you know, you can't do that. But I found a New York paper that printed the whole transcript on the front page. So what they were doing in the papers back then, it was the Wild West, but it was great for me. So it was a lot of newspapers, there's a lot of court cases I got lucky on. I found a lot of stories that people wrote right after this, for some of like the detective magazines. Some of those were just totally made up, but others were spot on. So it was a real Frankenstein's monster of stuff. But nothing really from her. I mean, the thing that astounds me to this day is, you know, she was a lawyer for the majority of her life, and she didn't even leave a will, which is, you know, again, goes to her mysterious end. Yeah, that's why I said, you know, it's not a biography, it's a mystery. And, you know, I like mysteries better.
You must start fleshing her out in a way that you almost feel you would see her if you walk down the street. What sort of things start playing on your mind and fill in the blanks that aren't there about her personally?
Yeah, so this one was a little harder because there wasn't enough, but she had such a big personality. And there was the good thing is there were a bunch of big interviews with her, so I could get a sense of her voice. And she was, you know, she was always late to court. She was always, her favorite store was Bergdorf Goodman. You know, and people would see her there and say, aren't you supposed to be in court? And she would, you know, say, oh, okay. And she always wore black, and nobody knows why. But some of the exchanges she has with people, you know, she settled many things out of court. She was one of the first to do that on the, you know, this kind of street level. So I think I did get a good sense of her voice. So if I saw her on the street, I think that I don't think she would surprise me, but at the same time, she's kind of endlessly surprising. You know, the fact that she would go down to the South dressed at one point she dresses like a man to enter one of these camps, and then she goes off to when the president, when Teddy Roosevelt shuts down her investigation of the slave camps. You know, instead of just ducking with her tail between her legs, she goes off to Europe and she says, I'm going to find where this is starting. And she finds this creepy barber shop in Italy where she finds the person who's trafficking these workers. And in, you know, in 1919 they called it white slavery, and which was, you know, kind of another name for prostitution. But, you know, it's human trafficking and we have it today. And it's the same thing, and she takes it right to the source. So she's kind of, I think I'd recognize her, and I think she'd be, you know, I hope she wouldn't, you know, sue me or something, because she was a good lawyer. But she's endlessly surprising, so nothing would, yeah.
Do you with the term fake news getting thrown around a lot lately on various news outlets, reading of all these news articles from 100 years ago, do you think there's very much difference in the way things were reported then as to now, or in a sense, things change but don't change?
Yeah, that's a great question. I've been thinking about that question a lot, so I'm really glad you asked that. So when Ruth disappears, the very first articles, you know, are these really tragic, you know, these pictures of her and where is she gone? Come home, Ruth, come home. But once the police kind of give up, and they really give up, and there's no clues, some papers just invent them. They're like, you know, oh, she was spotted on a boat going to Brazil. You know, she's been bought by a prince or something. You know, so they're just literally making it up to sell more papers. So there's definitely a lot of fake news that happened then that, you know, I didn't, you know, I just kind of chalked it up to the times when I wrote it. And then now, you know, you see what goes on now and like nothing has really changed. You know, let's sell some papers, you know, keep clicking on this to see what, you know, your favorite 80s celebrity looks like today. Yeah.
So you went from Superman to a super mystery woman. What's next?
I don't know what's next. I'm working on it. But it's interesting you bring that up because after I did the book on Superman, all these people are like, well, the next one's on Batman, right? And I said, you know, and I would just nod and say, oh, yeah, sure, sure. But I had no interest in writing about Batman, none. I mean, I like Batman, don't get me wrong, but, you know, Superman was, that was it. I knew I couldn't, you know, I just couldn't do it. So, but the ironic thing is I wrote about a rich person who shuns society life, wears all black, works outside the law. I wrote a book about Batman, except she's a woman and she's real, so she's better. Yeah.
You said this is a mystery and obviously we don't know what's happened to her. How long was she active in that? You said that she was most famous across New York and obviously America, but for how long? And then what is your thoughts as to why so little is known about her today, being the first woman district attorney and all the other things that she excelled at? Why do you think they don't know about her?
Great question. So she was active, you know, from one of the things I really was happy that I was able to do is look at her first cases. She does a death penalty case in New Jersey where a woman kills a man who attacks her, and in self-defense. But it's 19, you know, the court doesn't see it that way, and she's sentenced to hang. And Grace takes the case having never argued, right out of law school, having never been in a real courtroom. She takes the case. Sight unseen, never even met the woman. Antoinette Toll is her name. And it's, you know, the man who attacked her had a gun, but it disappeared, you know? So that's what you need to prove self-defense, and Grace finds the gun. So there's lots of oh, I just spoiled it, sorry. There's lots of early cases, but the way I structured the book is it jumps around in time because I wanted to show how the early cases kind of affected her solving this big case. You know, any detective will tell you it's their experience that makes a good detective. You don't go to school for it. It's you go through case after case and you pick things from the past to solve the present. But the second part, you know, why did she disappear? I think, and this is, you know, a theory without giving too much away, but it wasn't by accident. Again, if you make enough people angry, you know, they can get rid of you. And again, I don't mean, you know, get rid of you, but politically, she was silenced, and she had a huge political voice. She was in the newspapers almost every day, writing columns. We need to do this to protect our children, and this, you know, advice columns and law columns. So she was really silenced after this this case with the Army, and I think I put forth a couple of theories in the book. One, that there's one person who she really made mad, who she really was really angry at her for her whole career. And he's one of the most powerful men of the 21st century. You could 20th century. You could argue. I'll let you see who it is. But she makes a lot of people angry, and I think it's because she's a woman. She made the entire NYPD look like fools when she solved the Kruger case. After she solves it, they undergo the biggest investigation into their department to date, and it makes them look so bad. Because it makes them, people get fired right off the bat. It makes them not only, you know, negligent, but it actually shows evidence of possible being complicit to the crime itself, which is something we don't want to think about. I think there's reasons that she disappears, definitely. And, you know, it's kind of the ultimate disappearing act. It's disappearing from history, you know?
You just mentioned that disappearing from history. Was that through design then? I mean, do you know if things were possibly removed or something to help kind of eliminate her from history like that?
That would be really, that would have been a great last chapter. Well, I don't have proof of that, you know? But I think the way it happened, it was so abrupt that she was publicly shamed and disappeared, that I think when it happens that abruptly, and it could happen back then where everything was physical, you know, now you can't really erase someone, you know? They're always like around on the internet, I guess, but... don't look up, you know, old photos and stuff. But yeah, I don't know if it was that sinister, but I don't know that it wasn't. There are a lot of people that did not. I mean, she went after the Army on the eve of World War I, basically. One more.
Well, thank you so much, Brad, for coming tonight.
Thank you for coming.
And don't forget to join us in the rotunda for refreshments and book signing if you have further questions.
Thanks to the management and staff of the Hudson Library and Historical Society for their assistance in the production of this program and for providing the 2017 author series for the citizens of Hudson. For a DVD or Blu-ray copy of this or any HCTV program, contact Hudson Community Television at 330-653-2500 or via email at hctv@hudson.oh.us.